Hey, how's it going? We're going to talk quadrupoles today, but before we do, I got to talk to you about these things over here. Alternating current and direct current. So we got to talk a lot about how electricity works to understand how the quadrupole works. Let's start with the easier one. So DC only, in other words, like a battery, although it could be a power supply that's producing a direct current. All direct current means is that the voltage is constant. You turn the battery on and you get a positive voltage. You have flip things over, you can get a negative voltage as well. So you can decide how high up or how low you want to go. When we're talking about alternating currents, things get a little bit more complicated. So this is like the electricity that's coming out of a wall socket. It has a frequency to it. That means that the voltage will look like this. It's going up and down and up and down with whatever frequency. And it's defined by that equation up top there. So we can change the frequency, and you see it in the equation over there. So you see that this has twice the frequency of what I showed you before. And by the way, the frequency that we're dealing with, at least for quadrupoles, is in the RF region, the radio frequency region. So the radio frequency is actually a pretty broad region of the spectrum, but that's the zone that we're talking about here. Now we can change the magnitude of that frequency, so there's the waves are sort of tighter in this region over here. But what we can also do is we can offset the entire voltage. So if we apply a DC voltage, it takes the entire setup and raises it up. In other words, it's not evenly positive, negative, positive. It's actually spending more time in the positive region. And you could offset it negative. And we can also have it where it drops down into the negative region. So most of the time, this would be applying a negative voltage, but every so often it sort of pops into the positive region just for a split second. All right, so let's talk quads now. Quadrupole mass analyzers. We've seen this video before, so we know the basic configuration. They call it a quadrupole because it has four rods. There is such a thing as a hexapole or octopole. The main feature about these rods is that they have these oscillating charges. So the voltage is not just DC, it's a combination of DC and AC. So the polarity is sort of switching positive, negative. And the ions are going to move through these quads in this kind of weird dance that they go like that. It doesn't even look as the picture is showing up here. So I'll show you in just a second, maybe a better description of what it's actually doing. So the only way to think about this is if we divide the quadrupole along two planes. So we've got the rods on the upper portion, and then we get the rods on the side. The ones on the two sides, we're gonna call that the X plane, and then we have the Y plane as well. The voltage is like exactly the same, but with the opposite polarity to it. So that's not to suggest in the X plane that they're always positive. It just means that they're positive most of the time. And in the Y plane, they're gonna be negative most of the time. So they're kind of doing the opposite effect. One's positive, negative, and the other one's negative, positive, but for different periods of time. Let me explain that a little bit better. So to start with the simplest scenario, let's say that the rods are positive, like all of the time. That means that they're applying a force for positive ions that pushes everything exactly to the center. They're not going to move because the force is pushing equal opposite, pushing all ions of any size towards the center. Of course, as long as they're positively charged. Now, if the rods are negatively charged, well, there's going to be a pull. It's going to pull the ions away from the center. Some of them might pull up, some of them might pull down, but there's going to be this kind of cloud that's forming that bubbles outwards from there. That'll only happen until the charge reverses, and then it pushes the cloud back down. So you see this expansion and then collapsing of the ion clouds, all the while they're moving down through this tunnel. So this is a mass spectrometer, which means that we have ions of different mass to charge inside this electric field. So let's see what happens as we change the charge, the polarity of the quadrupoles for different ions. Well, there's still going to be that pull, and then the charge will reverse, and then it's going to push them back down. But what you're noticing here is that the smaller ions are moving out faster. The big ions sort of stay slow and stuck into the middle. So they're all pulsing up and down, but it's how big they pulse is going to depend on their mass to charge. And that's simply because small ions move quickly. The big ions have a lot of momentum. They're kind of sluggish. They stay put for longer. Okay, you're going to have to kind of just accept this for a minute, because I know the explanation I'm about to give, whenever you say it, you still look back at it and say, no, this doesn't make sense. But like, It's the best that we can do, at least for now. So let's think about the ions that are in the x-plane only. So we're just talking about those rods that are on the x-plane, and the x-plane is positive most of the time. So now I'm symbolizing it plus, 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 minus, plus, 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 minus. That's actually sort of through time. It's like 3/4 of the time it's in the positive, and then it dips to negative and comes back and forth. So these larger ions are going to be forced inwards to the center by the positive, and then the negative, there's going to be attraction out towards the rods. So as they move through the quadrupole, they're going to have this kind of up and down push on it, but most of the time the push will be towards the center. So the pulsation will kind of look like this. It's going to squeeze in and then come out, and squeeze in and come out, and ultimately stay towards the center, because most of the time the ions are being forced inwards. So that one makes sense, at least I hope it does. What about for the small ions? Well, the opposite scenario will happen. Because the ions are so quick to respond to a change in voltage, every time that voltage switches negative, they sort of pulse out a little bit more. These ions are destabilized, and they won't get through the quad. Yeah, I know. I know it's confusing, but like, here's the summary. The big ions are stable, the small ions are unstable. That's in the X plane. So if we go into the Y plane, now we're talking about the opposite polarity. So we've got, instead of mostly positive, it's mostly negative. And the exact opposite situation is going to occur. So now when the ions, the larger ones, are having this net force to pull them outwards, they're slow, but they're going to kind of gradually pull outwards by that net negative charge. And then the opposite happens for the small ions. I know what you're thinking. It's like, this, no, none of this makes sense. I agree, none of it makes sense. I'm not making this stuff up, I'm just spreading it on to you. There is another explanation, which I'll get to in a second, but let me just explain what we've done here. So we have a mass spectrum. The goal of a quadrupole is to basically select ions of a specific mass to charge. And it does that by eliminating all of the other ions except the one that it wants. The x-plane is eliminating one set, and it does it like this. So the x-plane cuts down all the small ions. The y-plane is designed to take away the bigger ions. And you can tune the voltage just right to create like a little bit of a gap between these two planes. So right now you're looking at a unit mass resolution window. All the ions that are sort of plus or minus a half, or one gap between the window, are stable and make their way through. And of course, to use this as a mass analyzer, all you need to do is change the voltage on these quadrupoles to sweep the spectrum, to scan from low mass all the way up to high mass. And in doing so, each of the ions has a turn at making its way through the quadrupole. So yeah, none of that really made sense. I know it wasn't really a satisfactory argument. It seems a little hand-washy. It's like ions are moving in and out, and I don't know. But like, there is a stricter definition to it. When it comes down to deciding if the ions are stable or not, we just simply have to calculate the forces. So the forces at play relate to the electric field, and the electric field is a quadrupolar field. So we can calculate the force that these ions are experiencing at any point within the quadrupoles. So we just take a look at these equations right here, and we take our potential in a hyperbolic field, which is dependent on the geometry of the system, where we decide exactly what the radius of the quadrupoles are, what the distance between them. You can define it along the x and y plane and the z plane as well. So we take partial derivatives. This is just a little bit of calculus. You can set the forces equal to zero because we know what's going on here. And now we can apply the electric force to an ion, which is proportional to the charge of each of the ions. Knowing, of course, Newton's law and force equals mass times acceleration, we can take these partial derivatives and work their way through. Everything's simple. It all works out until we come to these final equations, which are a little bit more complicated. In fact, mathematically, I don't know how to solve them. In fact, most people don't know how to solve these equations. Fortunately, somebody else solved them for us, so we don't have to do the math. All of that explanation, it's the technical explanation, but it's like, it's kind of this type of explanation. It's not something that's going to make much sense. Let's simplify this as well. Like, literally, let's simplify these equations right here. So what we're going to do is make two substitutions. We're going to call these symbols A and Q. A is related to the U value. The U is the DC voltage. I always remember it because it's AU. So A is related to the DC potential. Q is related to the AC potential. And we take these terms and we substitute it into this equation, and we get a simpler equation which can be plotted on a two-dimensional coordinate axis. So I know this symbol doesn't make sense, but the plot should. When you plot out this equation, this is the diagram that comes out from here. So it kind of looks like an iceberg. We're defining the A and the Q value on each of these axes, and we're looking at these zones of stability. This is actually just a partial portion of the entire region of stability. But basically it comes down to this. Anything inside the iceberg is stable. What that means is the ions will go through the quadrupole. If it's outside of the iceberg, we're in the unstable region, those ions are going to move up and down until they strike the quads and they don't get through. So any ion with its given M over Z will land somewheres inside of this plot. And that depends exactly on how you decide what voltage to set. So what is the magnitude of U and of V? So we pick that. And when we pick that, what we do is we fix it just onto that line. So that blue line is what we call the mass scan line. Those are the parameters that we define when we turn on the instrument. Now, by the way, when you operate a mass spec, the instrument's doing this for you, so you're not having to type these numbers in, but this is what it's actually doing. It's placing all of the ions on this virtual line. So the big ions are basically down in the bottom, and the small ions work their way up onto the top. And what we need to do is basically increase U and V proportionally. So you increase the two of them at the same time, and you're pushing the ions from the unstable region into the stable region. What you're doing is you're scanning that mass window over. You're taking ions that used to hit the quadrupoles, and when they hit the inside of that stable region, they no longer do. So when it comes down to it, the way that a quadrupole works is to control those voltage curves, to control the magnitude of the electric field. And we do that specifically by relating the DC potential and the AC potential together. Now, the other thing you can do here is you can actually play with the parameters a little bit. So if I wanted to control the resolution is basically how much of that line sits inside the stable region. So I can change the slope of that line. I'll do that by increasing U relative to V. And the slope goes up. So now, because it's only crossing just at a tip of that iceberg, the resolution is higher. The mass window is smaller. So I can change that resolution. I can go the other way, and I can go the extreme on the other way, where the curve actually lies flat. When we do that, what we've done is we've set the magnitude of U, the A term, to zero. Or another way of saying this is that this is RF only. We only have the AC potential. We only have the V, the Q term. So we call this RF only. So an RF-only quadrupole is one where basically every single ion that you can think of will still fit simultaneously inside the stable region. It's not scanning, it's not filtering any of these ions out. So since they all go through, it's acting exclusively to focus the ions. They're all being pushed to the middle. Now, where have we seen this? Why would we want to do this? Well, this is exactly what a collision cell is all about. With a collision cell, you imagine all those collisions, the ions are hitting each other, they're going to fly out on purpose. We need to keep them back towards the middle. So a quadrupole is a perfect way to do that. It keeps the ions contained as they go through the collision cell, they stay put in the center. So that's why I was saying that the middle quadrupole of a triple quad is not really a mass analyzer. It's not doing the job of a mass analyzer. It's acting like a lens or just a focusing setup, not as a mass analyzer.